Contrary to the popular narrative, Operation Market Garden was lost at Nijmegen. I've been over this in my very first documentary, which is still my most popular Battlestorm documentary. If you haven't seen it, you may want to watch that first, link below in the description. I also followed up this discussion in various other videos where I've explained the counter-arguments and debated the evidence, etc. In a nutshell, the 82nd Airborne Division didn't go for one of the bridges, but instead took a nearby hill, the Grosbeak Heights, and shelled a forest, the Reichswald, where no German troops were. Only several hours after landing did they decide to go for the bridge, and just before they got there, the Germans arrived and blocked them. This means that the tanks couldn't get over the bridge, and the delay at Nijmegen cost the entire operation. So, my initial conclusion 6 years ago, in 2015, was that the commander of the guys who landed at Nijmegen, General Gavin of the 82nd Airborne, was the one to blame, since he didn't send anyone to secure the Nijmegen Bridge until it was too late, and instead concentrated everything he had on the Reichswald Forest, because a rumour said that 1,000 German tanks were hiding in there. Well, people overreacted as always. They accused me of being anti-American and pro-British, even though that's just not the case. I was just following the evidence I had at the time. Later, I did a video on Browning, who was the corps commander above Gavin, and came to the conclusion that, while I still think Gavin was the main guy to blame, Browning definitely had his place, since he agreed with Gavin's decision to deprioritise the Nijmegen Bridge and go for the Reichswald. I said that I could understand if people would rather blame Browning than Gavin for the failure of Operation Market Garden, because the evidence would allow it, and it was just down to your interpretation of that evidence. I then did a video on Beevor's new book on the battle, Arnhem. On the one hand, I praised Beevor, saying that his book could have been the best book ever written on Market Garden, but that he had messed up on the Nijmegen issue. He just simply stated that Browning was to blame, and didn't present any evidence to back it up. And that's how I left it. Now, in a recent video of mine on another topic, I was replying to someone and was saying how history isn't a popularity contest, and that a compelling argument was all that matters. In response to me, Clone Warrior said, "At tick, you should reconsider your Beevor video then, and address the issue that Anthony Beevor had more evidence and sources than you ever had, over the issue of Browning directing Gavin not to go to Nijmegen until all other missions were accomplished. You primarily used a two books you evidence, which is at best a secondary sources. Beevor had access to and acknowledges the Cornelius Rhine collection in his book. In that collection there is first-hand documentation that Browning directed Gavin not to go to Nijmegen. This collection is available online, and it's box 100, folder 03. This original document justifies what Beevor wrote in his book, and proves the basis of your video is false." Further on, he says, "At tick, you don't have the best or right argument, some in cases such as the Beevor video. At tick, in Beevor's book he acknowledges contributions from the Cornelius Rhine collection at Ohio University. In that collection, which is available online, there is box 100, folder 03, Daily Plans, 82nd Airborne. On page 8 it clearly states that on September 16th, Browning directed Gavin not to attempt the seizure of Nijmegen Bridge until all other missions were successfully accomplished and the Berg and Dahl high ground was firmly in our hands. Your video narrative is a farce because your main evidence was from two other books, not primary sources. Your reasoning is exemplified by your bemusement and incoherence over Beevor stating Browning ordered Gavin to deprioritise the Nijmegen Bridge. Turns out, Beevor had access to original documents, and you have never acknowledged any fault." Yeah, I didn't acknowledge any fault because I didn't know about it. At Clone Warrior, "This is the first I've heard about it. If this is the case, this is fantastic. The reason finally can be revealed, and the blame can land squarely on Browning, assuming that this source definitely says that, and isn't flawed in another way. My only issue is that Beevor should have stated this in his book. Would have taken him a sentence or two to say it. Why didn't he?" Clone Warrior then gives me the link to the source, and then acknowledges he, meaning Beevor, should have included the quote and reference. Why not? He probably tasked an assistant to go through the collection. So even Clone Warrior admits that I was correct to criticize Beevor over his failure to provide the evidence in his book. Worse, my edition of Beevor's book doesn't have any references or citations, only a bibliography at the end. So I can't check any of the individual statements that Beevor makes. Therefore, I'm going to stand by my old criticism here and say that Beevor didn't provide evidence or a reference for his statements, and that fault definitely lies with Beevor. Also, just so everyone is aware, here is further evidence that YouTube automatically hides and or deletes comments without my input, because I had to go into the review folder to manually accept some of Clone Warrior's comments. Anyway, let's look at the evidence and assess it. On page 8 of this report from the 82nd Airborne, it does say that on the 16th of September 1944, there was a meeting where General Browning directed General Gavin not to attempt seizure of Nijmegen Bridge until all other missions had been successfully accomplished and the Berg en Dal high ground was firmly in our hands. Therefore, General Gavin isn't to blame, he was just following orders from Browning. Browning is, in fact, the one we should blame. End of story, good night. But is this really the case? The first rule of History Club is that you don't just take a source at face value, you have to scrutinize it first. So, we need to think critically here, and we need to ask questions like, what actually is this report? Who wrote these words? When was it written? How believable is this source? Is there any other evidence that contradicts the idea presented in this report? So, let's do that right now. On the second page of the October report, Gavin writes to Cornelius Ryan, the famous historian who wrote the book A Bridge Too Far, which later got made into the film of the same name. He does this because, as Gavin himself says, on page 4 you will note particularly Browning's directive to me of September 16th regarding the Nijmegen Bridge. He sent the October report to Ryan because, it seems, Ryan was asking about the Nijmegen Bridge issue. On the third page, which is the first page of the actual report, it shows that it was written by the Assistant Chief of Staff of the 82nd Airborne in October 1945. This is significant for two reasons. One, it wasn't Gavin who wrote this, although he may have had some input, since he was still the general in charge of the 82nd Airborne at this point. And two, this report was written after the battle. This is important because anyone can write anything after the event. They could have added in that Churchill himself glided in from the heavens to tell them to go for the Reichswald, but that wouldn't make it true. If it had been written prior to the battle, or even during the battle, without knowing the outcome, then this would have made it a much more reliable source. However, because it was written after the battle, we have to question whether what was written in this report was influenced by the fact that the battle was lost. They could have thought, you know, the battle is lost, it's our fault, so let's quickly blame Browning by saying he told us to go for the bridge. I'm not saying that that's what actually happened here, but the point is that because it was written post-battle, the contents of this report could be contradicted by other evidence that was given during or prior to the battle, and we should be more inclined to believe evidence written during or prior to the battle than evidence written after it. Now, as we said before, on the 16th of September 1944, the day before Operation Market Garden began, the October report does say that Browning told Gavin not to take the Nijmegen Bridge until after securing the Groesbeek Heights. This is what Beevor wrote in his book. On page 9 it goes on. Colonel Linguist at this meeting was directed to seize the high ground in the vicinity of Berg en Dal as his primary mission and to attempt to seize the Nijmegen Bridge with a small force, namely less than a battalion. Colonel Roy Lindquist commanded the 508th Infantry Regiment. Eventually he sent the 1st Battalion, commanded by Lieutenant Shields Warren, towards the Nijmegen Bridge, but by the time he got there, German forces had moved in and secured it, preventing him from taking the bridge. A great opportunity had been missed. The Nijmegen Road Bridge, at the start of that evening, had been defended by just 19 SS troopers from the Frundsberg, a dozen from the Hermann Göring Training Battalion, and a handful of reluctant Landsturm militia. Explosives were in place, but not wired up for demolition. Warren's battalion had clashed with German reinforcements, which had literally just arrived. The problem with the report in October 1945 is that it is contradicted by other evidence. In his book Lost at Nijmegen, Paulussen goes through some of the conflicting statements that were given by Gavin after the battle. In fact, in another response written in July 1945, so a few months earlier than the October report, General Gavin himself states this. "About 48 hours prior to takeoff, when the entire plan appeared to be shaping up well, I personally directed Colonel Lindquist, commanding the 508th Parachute Infantry, to commit his 1st Battalion against the Nijmegen Bridge without delay after landing, but to keep a very close watch on it in the event he needed it to protect himself against the Reichswald. 48 hours before the 17th of September puts us on the 15th of September, the day before Browning supposedly changed the orders. So you may argue that Gavin would be told by Browning to change the orders on the 16th, right? But according to Gavin's own account in 1947, that's not what Gavin did. Just before takeoff, I discussed the situation with Colonel Lindquist and directed him to commit not more than one battalion to the seizure of the Nijmegen bridges as soon as possible after landing, so as to take advantage of both surprise and darkness." So, we have one account, the earliest, by Gavin himself, saying that on the 15th he directed his men to Nijmegen Bridge without delay. Then we have the October report, a few months after the first, not written by Gavin, stating that Browning directed Gavin not to take the bridge. And then we have a third report, written 2 years later, in 1947, where Gavin says he told Lindquist on the 17th, just before takeoff, to capture the bridge. We then have Lindquist himself denying that he received pre-drop orders, stating that he only got told to go towards the Nijmegen Bridge after he was dug in to positions at Groespeak. Then we have the fact that Lindquist didn't move 1st Battalion towards the bridge for several hours after landing, and then in July 1945, in a different report, but again before the report in October 1945, Gavin was asked this question. "What person, staff or headquarters made the decision to apportion the weight of the 82nd Airborne Division to the high ground rather than the bridge at Nijmegen?" His response: "This decision was made by myself and approved by my corps commander." I mean, if Gavin was innocent here, he's really, really intent on digging his own grave. 1. He says that he made the decision, not Browning. 2. He says twice that he ordered them to go for the bridge, once on the 15th and just before takeoff on the 17th. 3. Lindquist later denied that Gavin gave him pre-drop orders. 4. The only evidence of pre-drop orders is Gavin's own words after the battle. 5. Gavin changes his mind in 1966 and tells Rhine that Browning was the one who made the decision, giving the October 1945 report to him. And 6. The October report is the only one saying that Browning made that decision. But again, this is written after the fact, wasn't written by Gavin, and is contradicted by Gavin himself. Well, which is it? Who's right here? Because clearly, regardless of what actually happened, the primary sources are all over the place. And personally, it seems to me that Gavin is the primary reason we're still having this debate, because he's the one giving us conflicting information. The question is, why? Why is Gavin not being straight with us? What is his primary motivation? In 1945, he could have simply come out and said, "Yep, Browning told me to ignore the bridge," and that would have been it. Then we would have had a consistent account, and we now know that it was Browning who was at fault. But Gavin didn't do that. Instead, he chose to do the exact opposite. He admitted that he was the one who made the decision, and then that it was approved by Browning. "This decision was made by myself and approved by my corps commander." This is interesting because Beevor states that Gavin was against the idea that Browning supposedly proposed. Right? Did Beevor not read Gavin's statement? And Mead, Browning's biographer, also states that Gavin and Browning were in fact in agreement over the issue, not in conflict. I mean, Beevor may have additional evidence that contradicts Mead and Gavin, but if he has, He hasn't presented it, so I can't be sure. Thus, Gavin is saying that he made the decision and that Browning approved it. He's also saying that he gave pre-drop orders when Linguist says he didn't. Therefore, the only sensible conclusion I can come to right now is that the October report is doubtful simply because of the weight of evidence against it. However, I'm not one to just dismiss evidence without at least some explanation as to why it could be wrong. And the question is, why would the Assistant Chief of Staff write that Browning made the decision if Gavin was the one openly admitting that he was actually the one who proposed it? Well, let's read it again. General Browning directed General Gavin not to attempt seizure of Nijmegen Bridge until all other missions had been successfully accomplished and the Berg and Dahl high ground was firmly in our hands. This doesn't say that Gavin didn't agree with Browning's decision or that Gavin didn't come up with it first. All it says is that Browning directed Gavin. Gavin could have come up with the plan, which he says he did, told Browning, who then agreed, which is what Gavin says he did, and then Browning turned back to Gavin and directed him to ignore the bridge. So this evidence may actually confirm my argument, not refute it, since this report does not necessarily contradict Gavin's other statement that he made the decision and it was approved by Browning. It also reinforces the idea that no pre-flight orders were given, because events, Paulison and Lindquist himself all show that no pre-flight orders were given. So, then the question becomes, if Gavin made the decision, and Browning approved of it, and there was no pre-flight orders to seize the Nijmegen Bridge, then why did Gavin say that he had given pre-flight orders? Right? If he had, then that would not only be against his own opinion, that the Grosbeak Heights were the priority, it would also be going against Browning's orders. So Gavin is admitting that he didn't follow orders by giving out the pre-drop orders. And we know he really didn't give those pre-drop orders. So why would Gavin say that he did if he actually didn't? Occam's razor suggests that Gavin was trying to cover his own back and so deflected blame away from himself towards Lindquist. This is, in fact, the conclusion that Paulison shows in his book. This is the simple answer and it makes a lot of sense. Blaming Lindquist gets both Browning and himself, who appear to have been in agreement over the Grosbeak issue, both of them off the hook, and shifts it to a subordinate commander who couldn't really defend himself if Gavin said he gave pre-flight orders. Gavin could have shifted the blame to the intelligence services. After all, they were the ones who said
1,000 tanks reported in Forest of Reichswald, E85 in Holland, on 8th of September, presumably a pool for refitting panzer divisions. We know that the men of the 505th Parachute Infantry Regiment spent the first day looking for the tanks in the Reichswald area, and discovered that they weren't there, and as Paulson says, still, if you think there might be a serious threat coming from the Reichswald, you do not send the entire 508th Parachute Infantry Regiment, except D Company, towards their objectives, and you do not sight the headquarters of the 82nd Airborne, the 505th Parachute Infantry Regiment, and the 1st Airborne Corps so close to a possible front line. So this might be the reason Gavin didn't blame the intelligence reports. Because not only is it insane to believe that the Germans would have 1,000 tanks in a forest in the middle of nowhere in 1944, but it would have also highlighted the stupidity of the airborne commanders, including Gavin, to have set up camp right next to 1,000 panzers.
Now again, I'm not saying that Browning was innocent here. Far from it. I actually think he was wrong for approving Gavin's orders. Assuming he did, because the only evidence I've seen for him doing that was Gavin's dubious post-battle reports. But the October report by itself doesn't confirm that Browning was the guy to blame. So overall, given the current evidence, the most reasonable interpretation is that Gavin is still the one who messed up and caused the failure of Operation Market Garden. This then leads us right back to Clone Warrior's original comments.
At tick. You should reconsider your Beevor video then, and address the issue that Anthony Beevor had more evidence and sources than you ever had. You primarily used a two books you evidence, which is at best a secondary sources. This original document justifies what Beevor wrote in his book, and proves that the basis of your video is false. None of this is true. You even admit that Beevor should have shown his hand when it came to the Gavin and Browning issue, and he didn't. When the source was provided, as I've explained in this video, it doesn't hold up to scrutiny. I didn't use two books, I used several, and not just secondary sources. I used primary sources like Urquhart's and Frost's memoirs, so this statement is incorrect. I did rely on the secondary sources, but that's because I like to stand on the shoulders of giants. Paulison's book, Lost at Nijmegen, is very, very good, which is why I've relied upon it again here, and I'd recommend that you pick it up, Clone Warrior. And I would say that the basis of my video isn't false, and neither is my argument, which you state isn't the best or right argument. Well, currently, I'd say it is. You then say, your video narrative is a farce because your main evidence was two other books, not primary sources, and that I never acknowledged any fault. Well, I've just used primary and secondary sources, including the evidence you provided, to show you why my argument stands up against both Beevor's and yours. I'm not going to acknowledge a fault when there isn't one. And also, even if this evidence did prove that the interpretation I had 6 years ago in 2015 was incorrect, it wouldn't mean that it was a farce back then. What did I say in that video? What did I say in my very first documentary in 2015, the Market Garden documentary?
Of course, history does not stand still. Tomorrow, new evidence or a new theory could come along and sweep away the conclusions we make today.
Oh, what's that? I acknowledge that new evidence or a new theory could make my conclusions obsolete. Oh, and this is actually part and parcel of the craft of history, which I've outlined in my history theory video. Look. I'm more than happy for new evidence to come along and 100% prove that Browning was the guy to blame. I really am. Why? Because then we'd all know who was to blame, and we could just stop with this debate and move our energies onto the next debate. I have no problem standing here saying my conclusions in 2015 are out of date. Gavin is innocent. Browning sucks. No problem at all. That's not because I have no backbone and can't stand here defending my position like I am now. I can absolutely do that, and I've done it numerous times over numerous topics. The reason why is because I'm not here to be right. I'm here to find the truth. So it doesn't matter if everything I make today turns out to be wrong in 10 years' time, right? Great. That's what I want to see happen, because history doesn't stand still. It moves forwards generation after generation. History is constantly being rewritten as new evidence and new interpretations come along, sweeping away the conclusions we make today and pushing us closer and closer towards the truth, because that's what history is. History is the study of the human condition, and it evolves just like we do. I can only work with the evidence that we currently have today. If tomorrow someone finds a whole new drawer of documents, then we'll have to reassess. But that doesn't mean that the conclusions I, or anyone else, come to today are a farce. How can I predict the future? I really don't understand the hostility in your comments. And it's not just you. There's plenty of other people who are just as eager to try and take me down, as though that will somehow prove I'm a fraud or whatever. Right, for starters, it won't, because nothing I've done is disingenuous. I've tried my best with the limited sources that I have to provide you with the best narratives that I can in the most entertaining ways that I can. I'm not always right, and I do make mistakes, and I'm not all bells and whistles, but I'm genuinely trying. So even if you had been right here, I would have just congratulated you, like I did in my initial response to you. And despite the fact I'm having to defend myself from your accusations of my videos being a farce, I'm still thankful that you brought this information to me so that I could make another video on about this topic and address the issue. So thank you for that. But there was no reason for the hostility. I think people, not just you, but many people, have been so badly taught by our miseducation system that they think that the best way to have a debate is to destroy your opponent's personality. No, it's not. You destroy their arguments, not their personality. You fight back with evidence and interpretation, and you do so as respectfully as you can. Their personality, for the most part, is irrelevant. It might be relevant if they're blinded to the facts because of their ideology or their upbringing, to the point where they just dismiss the facts. Then yes, their personality might be relevant, and in such cases, name-calling might be the only appropriate response. But even then, I would suggest ignoring them is the best way to go. For people willing to actually debate you in order to get to the truth, defeat their argument, not their personality. Just like with Nigel Askey, you could have presented evidence and I could have thanked you, taken it away and talked about it in front of thousands of people, and we'd all be talking about how great Clone Warrior was, or Nigel Askey, for allowing us to debate this once again. Instead, you both decided to be antagonistic, and now I have to address the attitude. So, to all of you out there trying to take me down, you need to rethink, right? You shouldn't be trying to take me down, you should be trying to persuade me that your argument is correct. Calling me names or presenting random bits of evidence without taking the time to think about the evidence first to see if it actually reinforces my position isn't going to persuade me. Plus, if you call me names, I'll just call you them back, I don't care. And even if you do win the debate, you don't pummel your opponent with insults. I'm not going to stand here gloating saying, yeah, Clone Warrior, get told. I'm not going to do that because that's pathetic. So please, all of you, please stop with the hostility. If you're going to present information to me or argue against me or others, do it politely. Persuasion is the name of the game. Not insults, not dismissing their evidence, not getting all the nerds on 4chan to swamp a video full of downvotes in an effort to undermine my legitimacy. None of that works. If you're not trying to persuade someone to reconsider their point of view, then you're wasting your time. And theirs. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.